Welcome to the Bulletproof Cashflow podcast, the go-to place to gain financial freedom through real estate investing. Here we interview investors, mentors, and entrepreneurs who share their secrets and advice to help you build passive income. Let's get into the show.
Hey everyone, this is Augustino. The one thing that I come back to in our podcast is about having the right mindset and surrounding yourself with like-minded people. This is where your success begins. Today's guest not only has the right mindset, but also makes people her priority. She's invested in well over 1,000 units and have no signs of slowing down anytime soon. Aside from her traditional buy and hold portfolio, she's also the CEO of Direct Source Wealth, a real estate investment development company that leverages vacation rentals to reduce vacancies, boost rent rates, and improve tenant quality in rental units. She kicked off her career in her teens and began building her personal wealth in real estate in the stock market. So while investing in real estate, she began her career as a financial advisor at Edward Jones and has since left that role years ago. You know, today, she owns her own investment firm and owns properties around the world, including places like Washington State, Colorado, Arizona, Illinois, Ohio, Puerto Rico, France, and many other places. You know, with that, I'd like to welcome Kira Golden to the show. Thank you, Kira, for being on. I really appreciate it.
Oh, thank you so much for having me. I know it's been a challenge coordinating, and I'm really glad you've been patient with us. It's fun to talk with you.
Yes, yes, yes. Looking so forward to our call. So before we begin, if you like what Kira has to say, you can check out the website at directsourcewealth.com, or you can reach out to her at dave@directsourcewealth.com. Okay, Kira, so go ahead and tell the listeners about how you got your start in real estate.
Yeah, I think many of us have the same experience. It's like I was born knowing I wanted to do this. And I didn't know how, I didn't know what it was going to look like, but I just knew that, and it really wasn't that I knew I wanted real estate, it's that I knew I wanted passive cash flow and I wanted that particular lifestyle. And real estate quickly became the mechanism to do it. And I was one of, I guess, the early adopters from Robert Kiyosaki. I mean, I was 12 years old reading Rich Dad, Poor Dad and going, yeah, this makes sense. Let me figure out how to do that. And gosh, some of that was even before the book came out, you know, when he had his little infomercial about investing on late night infomercial TV. So, you know, I don't let my kids watch TV, but maybe I should because that's where I got started.
I mean, that book was so influential for a lot of people. I mean, so many. I think the concepts in that book were very powerful. So how did that mindset affect you early on then? What exactly did you envelop where it actually caused you to move into that direction?
One of the first things really wasn't even specifically about real estate. He talked about inflation and how inflation decreases our purchasing power over time and how even when we sit and save money, sitting in a bank account, that's losing money. Because we're not keeping pace with inflation. And in my little pea brain mind, that clicked. I was like, oh gosh, yeah, my, you know, $3,000 of life savings, you know, from lunch money and Christmas money and birthday money and whatever. I was like, it's, you know, it's flittering away. And as a kid, I really internalized also that I had a huge opportunity to take risk. I mean, if I took risk at 15, 18, 20, 25 years old and made a ton of mistakes and had to start over at 30, I'd still be probably ahead of most of my peers because I'd at least know all the things not to do from my mistakes.
Yep.
And so, you know, coupled with the risk-taking element and the fact that my cash sitting there doing nothing was like an automatic loss, I started to take action. And I really think that just taking action was the most important thing. I've made a ton of mistakes, but every time I learn from it, we synthesize it, we get better. And that all comes from taking action. If I just sat and tried to like master it all from a book, it just never would happen.
Yeah, absolutely. No, I found the same thing too. You know, I used to write business plans for hours and really, that's one thing, but then execution is everything, you know, right afterwards.
Yeah. And execution is a lot of times made up on the fly. And for me, you brought this up before our call, being willing to just say, hey, I need to get a bunch of people's opinions about how to do this and synthesize it and then take a course of plan every day, reevaluating and updating that plan of action, you know, with feedback of people who've been there and done that before. You know, I learn because I know the right questions to ask because I'm in the suit. So when I go to a mentor, it's like I'm asking a very specific pointed question about how to handle a specific situation. And you learn a lot more from that than, you know, sort of this broad theoretical, hey, what if?
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Well, tell us about your first deal then. Is that, did you use a mentor to get into that first one or?
I mean, yeah, if you count your parents, which I do, know, my folks weren't involved in real estate, but they bought single family homes, and they certainly knew a heck of a lot more than I did when I bought my first. And I have to correct the record. I think we've been saying for a while that I was 18 when I bought my first single family, but we actually went back and audited it. And I think it was either 19 or just turned 20 when it actually went under contract. So I don't want to misrepresent anything. But you know, my folks really, they helped. They helped me, you know, how to pick up the phone and call a real estate agent. I didn't know how to do that. And even, you know, what to look up to find a lender who would make me a loan. And most importantly, they encouraged me. I mean, I was told no a lot as a teenager trying to buy a house. A lot of lenders wouldn't even waste their time with me. And it took a long time for somebody to take me seriously. And my folks just kept encouraging me. And that's invaluable.
Yes. To have a support system at home is so important. I mean, and it's funny because even this past weekend, I was talking to some people at our meetup. And one of the things I said, you have to make sure that your partner is on board, your support system's in place that is going to help get you through the hard work it takes to take down deals. Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. So since that first one, though, you started really making buying up at a rapid pace, I think, right?
Yeah, I mean, in the beginning, it wasn't that rapid. I mean, it was a home a year, some options, a couple of wholesaling deals. Because, you know, I was in college full time and working as a nanny full time and having to, like, you know, do this on the side. So like so many people, that you're balancing a lot of things. And I really wasn't privileged enough to be able to really go full time until 2009 is when I went absolutely full time. And so that shifted everything. It also made it a lot scarier because, you know, if you're going to do it right, you need a team around you. You need professional accounting, you need professional asset management, professional underwriting, which means payroll. Payroll means you're now in the business of doing deals. You've got to do deals. And so what we really focused on in this last, you know, 8-year run of real estate was getting our portfolio with our co-investors to a size that the portfolio sustained itself and the staff necessary to run it in a professional way, because, you know, working evenings and weekends didn't cut it anymore. That's another major milestone that we are cresting over. We haven't, you know, we see the light at the end of the tunnel. By the end of this year, we should be there. And that's huge, because then you now are at scale, but you don't have to do another deal to survive. And so that just kind of allows you to be a little more picky in the deals that you do. And so, you know, we're excited about entering that next stage.
Yes. Now, as you continue building then, so if I heard you right, you're building the cash flow up, it's coming in. So what does that mean for you as from the business perspective then? Does that mean that you're going to be able to focus more time on, say, social media or doing other things or just spending more time with the family? Or what does that mean?
Well, so interestingly, what it means for me personally is I'm finally going to be able to take a reasonable paycheck again. It's been quite a sacrifice building the business in terms of, you know, to support staff when there wasn't enough cash flow coming in. Guess whose cash flow got hit? You know, mine.
Yeah.
So I'm excited about that and you know, kind of getting back to where I was even before. Because, you know, one thing, when you level up, you have to first hunker down, right? So there's a little bit of a sacrifice. So we should be kind of having some breathing room again on that front. And then as far as like the time, where we're going to spend the time, we're actually coming attractions. We're launching Direct Source Wealth Advisory. So we are going through the process of registering to become a registered investment advisory firm focused on real estate and leveraging
awesome.
The experience that I've had as using stocks and real estate together to build that cash flow stream, where we can actually not just sponsor deals, but now we'll also be able to take on clients and advise them on what steps to take. Because it's something I feel is really missing in the alternative asset space. You know, you go to your self-directed custodian and they can't give you advice. They could just, you know, they can fill out the forms on your behalf. They're your custodian, but they can't say, hey, look at this deal or look at that deal. You go to the sponsor and obviously the sponsor is going to say, hey, here's my deals, right? Here's my wares. Do you want to buy them? And so we really get to come into that space and begin to work with an investor on a strategic level and say, okay, here you are now. Where do you want to be? What's it going to take to get there? And some of that might be in direct source wealth, private equity deals, but lots of it I anticipate is going to be with other sponsors who can be on our platform. So we're really, really excited to be focusing on that going forward.
Awesome. No, that's great. I definitely want to talk to you about that after the call. That sounds very interesting. Very good stuff. But you did mention something. I think that's probably one of the driving fears that many of the people that listeners have, is that they're afraid to, you know, cut their 40-hour job to go and do this full time. And just like you said, I think you said you've been working at this for like 9 years or something like that before you can actually take a paycheck. And but now you have all the freedom in the world, right? I mean, you could do what you want. You can start building on other things, right? That's a great thing about it.
Yeah, you know, I mean, here's the thing, right? Like, we all have fear. I have a less and less as I've gotten, as all of the things I'm afraid of have happened to me. When you get to the other side of it, you have less fear left. But I still have things I fear, and you just do it anyway.
Yep, that's right. But a big part of getting over that is mentors. Now, aside from your parents, I already know your backstory, but I know that you leveraged mentors many, many times. I think you still do today to take down deals, right? And maybe you could talk a little bit about some of the mentors you've had, some of the most influential ones.
Yeah, I may not make friends doing this, but I have a philosophy against paying for mentorship. And my thought on this is, if somebody is significantly more sophisticated than you and you want them invested in what you're doing, a paycheck isn't going to do it for them. They know how to make money. That's why you want them on your team. So what you have to give them is participation or something else they value, whether that's a feeling of satisfaction or joy or excitement. I mean, people have been in the business for a long time, get bored. They've seen everything. They know how to do everything. And so, you know, if you bring excitement and vigor and energy to it, you know, that could just be an enjoyable experience for a mentor, right? To contribute and be part of something. So mentors who are really, really successful are going to pick and choose who they work with. They're not going to do it for a paycheck. They're going to do it because it feels good to them to be involved, and because they want to make a contribution, and because there's maybe something in it for them too when the project's successful. So I really focus on enticing a mentor in with a deal and saying, hey, let's do this deal together. And, you know, I'll take a much smaller piece of my initial deals with my mentors because I want them to be incentivized on the deal. I don't want to be paying for classes or workshops or whatnot. I want to really learn on the ground, boots on the ground, and I want them invested in my specific project, not just in some esoteric philosophy about how to invest.
Now, what would you say is probably one of the most valuable things you learned from a mentor? That's a loaded question. There's a lot of, I'm sure.
Privacy. I mean, you know, I still do a lot of these podcasts, and I'm a pretty open person, and I like to share myself and I like to share what I've learned and connect. But the more I've worked with other investors and really sophisticated investors, you know, you rarely hear from those people. They're not public people, and there's good reason for it. You know, I think I've become more private as I've learned from my mentors why they are that way, and, you know, really just buckled down and focused on the work.
Interesting. All right, good. So now maybe we can discuss a challenging situation and how you got out of it, maybe with the help of mentors, perhaps. Like maybe you have one that you a really hairy deal or a very hairy situation?
We're right in the middle of one right now, actually.
Good.
So, we have a deal that's kind of your classic hairy thing, right? It's taken longer than expected. It's cost more than it's expected. And we're just really saved by the fact that we bought in the right market. And overall, the project's going to be, I believe, quite profitable. I can't go into the specifics of it because we are working through it right now, but I'll talk about some of the things that we've had to do. I mean, and one of the biggest lessons I've learned is you pick up the phone, you be in communication with people. You tell them what's going on, the good, the bad, and the ugly. And one of the things I've really learned is that you really don't know who you're dealing with until things go wrong. And that's true both ways in a relationship. It's true for the investor. You know, if you've been getting your returns, and there's a company out there I'm familiar with that they've been paying their investors have gotten every return that was promised every time until the Ponzi scheme collapsed. Right? Like, and so just because you're getting your return doesn't always mean everything's going fine. And yet investors tend to assume that. So my more sophisticated investors say, look, if I'm not once in a while hearing about a problem and everything's always roses and sunshine and unicorns and rainbow poop, then, you know, I'm a little nervous, right? Because life isn't that easy.
Right.
And so the flip side is true too. Like when we have to deliver news or anticipate, hey, we anticipate there may be a problem and we're getting ahead of it, I really pay attention to which of my investors freak out and which of my investors are like, okay, let's think about this. How are we going to solve it? And we are getting more and more careful and more picky about who we will let invest with us. Because, you know, we really are looking to do this for the next 40 years. And that takes long-term relationships with people who can give and take both directions and who can see that we are our word. It doesn't mean we'll do everything perfectly, but we're going to stand by and be transparent and communicate and deal with problems directly and head on and honestly. And we need to be with people who can handle that, who don't freak out when you deal with things that kind of make you feel like, oh, it would have been better if I just kept my mouth shut and tried to solve this on my own, because that's never the right answer.
That's right. Yeah, and absolutely. You know, if an investor is going to be negative as well, or they're going to be they're going to start crying every time you need a new roof or whatever. Yeah, you don't need those people around.
Yeah, they really shouldn't be investing. They don't get it.
That's right.
The problem is sometimes you don't always learn that until you've gone through something, right? People can be very bravado and talk a big game, and it's not until something really happens that you realize if they can really handle it or not.
That's right. So now when you're looking at a deal, when you're looking at a property, how do you decide if it's going to be a good deal or not?
I wish I could always say which ones were going to be grand slams, right? Because then I would only do those.
Of course.
Generally, what we're looking at is upside is only about 10% of our analysis. Downside is about 90%. And what I mean by that is if I decide I'm going to do a deal, it's because I want to know all of the things I think could go wrong and how will we end up if one more or all of those things go wrong. And if we're going to end up breaking even with everything going wrong, then that's probably a deal worth doing, because the chances that everything are going to go wrong is pretty slim. And then the second part of the equation is what's the upside? So we come from a perspective of preservation of principal first, and then what's the upside and how are we being compensated for the risk piece of that? So we start with the risk analysis. What are the things that could go wrong? How secure do we think this investment is? How likely is it to go as planned? And then we price in the risk, and then we look at what's our minimum upside to do the deal.
Okay. Do you find that at this point in the market, in these various markets that you are investing in, because you're global at this point, yeah, is the overheating just taking place here in the States? Is it happening everywhere? Like, how do you see it right now?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's still pockets in the U.S. that aren't overheated. And I know that, like, we're very focused right now down in Puerto Rico, because it crashed a few years after the U.S. and it's recovering a few years after. And there's some other pressures, opportunity zones and post-hurricane money and insurance resources, all positive pressure in the direction of making it better. So we're negotiating right now a 500 single family portfolio that we're going to take down over the next few months and reposition down here, some as flips and sales to long-term residents, some as vacation properties. But I'm still looking for it. I did this back in 2006. I stopped investing in the U.S. and started looking over in Europe. I can't just sit on my money, because that goes back to my initial Kiyosaki thing. It's just sitting there and inflation's eating it away. So my job is to look around and go, okay, where there's always an opportunity. There's always a market. It drives me crazy when people say, I'm just going to sit tight and see what happens.
Oh yeah. You can't do that.
They're missing it. We're missing it. Your job is to be paying attention to where is it going and where is the opportunity. And you know, right now for us, that's Puerto Rico. That's where we see.
Yeah. One thing I like about Puerto Rico is that you get to leverage, well, you get to have American leverage of capital there, but it's still a very different type of place to be, you know? So it's a beautiful place and the weather's awesome. Yeah. So aside from that, those people need help and you're obviously helping them by investing in their space.
I love what you just said, because this gets overused in our, you know, it's kind of like talking about being green nowadays. It's, you know, impact investing, and it gets really overused. And what does it even really mean? But I will say for us, it is a very practical, concrete application. I mean, we have a mission to use our money to make an impact and make a difference. And I don't think that should come. I remember back when Calvert Mutual Funds was first launched as like a social mutual fund. I remember the rep sitting in my office, you know, saying, hey, you know, you need to tell your investors that they're going to make 1 or 2% less, but they're going to be doing social good. And I was like, no, you need to go back to your analysts and you need to figure out how social good pays. And then we're going to do that.
That's right.
We want to do good, but don't tell me that doing good has a less, it flies in the face of everything I believe to say that it is less profitable to do good business, right? Like, yeah, it is more profitable because you have more trust, you're making an impact, you're doing things well. So you should be able to spend less on legal, less on being sued, less on, you know, and all of those things translate to better bottom line profits. Investing in communities where there's no liquidity like Puerto Rico are high profitability margin markets, and you're doing good. And so to me, it's like, we're always looking for ways to marry those two things and outperform because of the social good we do, not say, hey, we're going to do a little less because we're doing something nice.
Right, right, right. No, I find that when the more you give, the more you get back.
Absolutely.
That's a rule. Yeah, absolutely. It's a rule for me anyway. But how do you use leverage in places like France or in the EU, for instance? I mean, leverage there is very different than it is here, isn't it?
Yeah, my credit is shot in France. My first time I did something over there, I just got a mortgage. I found a bank in England that pretty much made bank loans to English residents in France. And I said, well, if you can make loans to English residents in France, you can make loans to American residents in France. So anyway, we were able to do that. And I got a mortgage over there. But I will say it's challenging. I mean, I was saying I think my credit's shot there because I still have issues getting the payment to them every month, right? Like we have it set up on auto payment. We try to do that. But there are definitely additional problems. I finally had to get just like a local attorney to kind of manage that whole process, which again goes back to why when you do these things, you got to think of them in economy of scale, you know, so that you can have on staff somebody who can make sure that the payments are being made and everything's being processed. It's no different. All of those countries have the same systems and processes that we have here. They're just slightly different and they're in another language. But, you know, they have mortgages and they have leverage and they have, you know, all of that. They have credit systems, you know, but I had to prove my credit in a different way. I had to negotiate directly with the bank and say, hey, you know, I don't have a cell phone bill and a rent history or anything in France, but I can send you what I have in the States and, you know, prove my credit with the bank there. And I did, like, I'm not kidding. I mean, I bought in 2007 over there. And I shot my credit in EU and I had to then rebuild my credit. Like I have great credit in the States, but we missed a bunch of payments and didn't even know and, you know, whatever. So then we had to rebuild everything.
Yep. I think what it is that here in the States, the same sort of rules apply, just like you just pointed out. And you have to really demonstrate to the bank that you're credible, demonstrate to your investors that you're credible. And I think many of the people that are starting out in this game, they have a hard time conveying that. You know, and
I'm the worst at it. I am the worst. The last thing I want to be is institutional or credible. I mean, I am like the barefoot Contessa. I like to, you know, walk around being all hippy dippy. And, you know, so I walk into a bank and I'm like, oh my God, they hate me. Immediately they hate me. And it's true. We go through this $8.5 million loan underwriting process and their comment was, you know, they're not institutional. And I'm like, damn straight, we're not institutional. That goes back to finding mentors and people who believe in you and who go, look, no, she's not. She's weird and she's quirky and she's a hippie. But that doesn't mean she's not smart and capable and can't manage this real estate deal. And they fight for you. And they fight for you. And it's like women wouldn't have the right to vote if there weren't men that stood up and said women should vote, right? And blacks wouldn't have equality if there weren't whites who marched alongside them, right? And there aren't, you know, small independent hippie syndicators who wouldn't be able to do deals if old white men in suits didn't say, no, she's legit, right? And so being authentic with people, finding those relationships and then sticking with those people. So the lenders who do a good job of packaging me and making me look like lenders want me to look, not making things up, but helping comb through all the facts to find the relevant ones that I don't know are relevant. Those are the people I love and adore and appreciate and credit for, you know, it's like they want to take me out to lunch after we close a loan. And I'm like, no, I should be taking you out because someone had to like package this all up and make me, you know, look like a 65-year-old old white man.
But you know what though? I think what you're doing is, well, you mentioned something right at the beginning is that you're actually giving them value back though. That's the key. Because oftentimes I'll get people that come to our events here, our live events, and they'll say that they want to do a deal with me. They'll just send me a listing from LoopNet and said, hey, I found this. And I'm
right,
awesome, thanks. What am I supposed to do with this?
I had somebody try to sue me because he was, quote, a commercial wholesaler. I won't name the company that he represented on a deal that I bought. And he said he sent me that deal. Now, it was an unopened email I'd never received from a link on LoopNet on a public listing on a deal that I actually bought because I knew the seller personally. And the seller would be more than happy to say that in court. And yet he tried to sue me for his, you know, that I cut him out of the wholesaling deal. I mean, there's so many people who are just like throwing mud at the wall to see that it'll stick. And
yeah, so much of that garbage going on. But I mean, ultimately, you know what? You really have to demonstrate that value. And if you want to work with a mentor, they have to. I know the mentors, like I have my rule of 33. I spend 33% of my time with my peers, 33% of the people of where I want to be in 10 years, and 33% of the people people I can help. But at the same time too, they really have to put an effort to, listen and apply.
Well, and the same is true for us. I was going to say one of the things with mentors too is you got to be coachable. And each of us has to decide on our own which hills we're willing to die on. Like, I have a nose ring and Edward Jones wanted me to take it out. And I was like, no, nope, that's all right. I'll change my job. And they said, no, nope, you're good enough at what you do. We'll allow it. I don't like wearing shoes, but sometimes I do put them on. Like, if I'm going to go meet with a chief of credit, underwriting, pencil pusher, who I want to be sensitive to it. I'm not meaning to diminish that person. They're incredibly valuable in my world and what I do. And I appreciate them. And that's why I will put on a suit and I will get a babysitter for my kids and I'll wear shoes to go meet with them. Even though 9 times out of 10, I'm not doing that. I'm dragging my kids along with me because they're part of what I do. And I'm, barefoot and whatever, but figuring out which parts of your identity are really just who you are and non-negotiable. And then what things you are willing to be molded on and how you're willing to let that go.
Yeah. Well, and you know what though? I think all that fits into the mindset. It's really about the mindset of being coachable. Yes. But also how important is it to you? Right. And then it's so much a big part of really applying yourself to keeping your mind open. Right. Mm-hmm. But I imagine that you're part of some masterminds, I'm guessing, right, these days.
I should be. And I've had a challenge with doing that because of my travel schedule and my moving around. I've checked out EO, I've checked out YPO, I've looked at different mastermind groups. Tiger 21, all these different organizations. And part of the problem of these two is that they fall back into that same thing I have my own issue with, which is paying for mentorship and community. I feel like these things are free exchanges. So I'm not part of an official group. I just have, I guess this is a mastermind, but we're not under any sort of official thing. There are a group of us investors who meet for breakfast every week. And we look at each other's deals and we brainstorm about problems and we talk through things, but it's all in a much, much less official capacity than a mastermind or an organization or group that I'm part of.
Yeah. But you know what, even those sorts of interactions are important, right? You're not worried about them taking your deals or anything else like that either, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's good. That's good. So now, where do you think your mindset now originates? Where do you pull your grit and determination from? Where does it all come from?
I mean, from God. I mean, it's source. It's every time. That's why we're called direct source wealth. It's I want to be a channel of the work that God wants to see done on this planet. And I believe that that work that's being done, and I'm just a small part of it, is really about making us a kinder, gentler, more comprehensive community of people and channeling wealth into the hands of those kinds of people so that they can then go out and do their work. So when I want to quit, when I get a loan denial, when somebody says I'm not good enough or I'm not professional enough or I'm not institutional enough or I'm not this enough or that enough, I fall on my knees and I just ask again, should I be doing this? Is this what I'm supposed to do? And I probably question it 5 times a day lately. And then I get up and I keep doing it because I'm not here for me. I'm here to be used because that feels really good. It feels really good to feel like I'm serving my purpose, but I'm here to make a difference. And so I can't quit. It's just not an option.
Awesome. No, that's great. That's great. I mean, you really have to have a powerful why too. I mean, that's a thing, that's your why as well. It sounds like.
Yeah. Money is neutral. Money is just a tool like anything else. And the old paradigm where the money was controlled by people with scarcity mentality and competition and slicing the pie smaller and smaller, they are fading away. They don't know it yet. They don't realize that their rug's about to be pulled out from under them, but it is. And there is a sea change happening in the world because of technology, because of the raising of the consciousness of the population, yep. Because of the removing of the disintermediaries and the control systems that have been in place. we are collectively getting more and more money into the hands of the people who are really meant to have it. And it's going to make a huge difference in the world.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I think what you just described is some of the limiting beliefs that people still have today. And it's not there. Those bars are not on those windows anymore. They're gone.
Yeah, it's done. It just has to play out, but it's already written.
Yeah. And I mean, part of it too is I think it takes some degree of sacrifice. You know, you made sacrifices to get to where you are right now. You know, yeah, you have over 1,000 units. It's awesome. Most people only dream about even having just 100, but it's not without sacrifice. You sacrificed a lot to get there. So, and that's important. You know, you have to give something up.
You have to give everything up. You have to give up every idea of what you think you are, what you're meant to do, who you're meant to be, what you're meant to have. Every limiting belief from birth that you didn't even know you had, and just say, I'm willing, use me. And then it's crazy what happens.
Yep, that's right. Totally agree. Well, let's get into the bullet round. So I'm going to ask you some rapid fire questions. You ready?
Yep.
All right. This question is going to be a little weird because you've already answered it. But if you can give your 20-year-old self a word of advice, what would you tell her?
I just think bigger, go harder, take more risk, even more than I did.
Yeah, because of course you had the mentors, your parents, but you're only limited to what you had at that time, right?
Yeah.
It's funny because I tell people the same thing. People are thinking about buying a duplex. I'm like, go bigger. What are you doing?
Yeah.
How many units? 20 units, 24 units. Well, I can't do that. Yeah, I need to do that. What are your three most influential books and why?
So I just started reading The Richest Man in Babylon, and that's been amazing. Amazing. Recommended by a friend and mentor. Obviously, Rich Dad, Poor Dad, and then Baby Wise, because then any of you who have children know that if your kids don't sleep, you can't do jack. And Baby Wise is a great sleep training book.
Yes. Good for parents. Yes. Yes. Absolutely. And then, you know what? I think I already have insight. I'm going to ask you anyway. So what's your philosophy for life and success? What motivates you?
I mean, it's life of service. Success is service. And find what you're meant to do. Whatever you put your hands to do, do it with your whole heart and give till you feel like you can't give any more, and then give some more.
Excellent. All right, guys. If you want to reach out to Kira, you can reach out to her at directsourcewealth.com. I hope you got a lot of great insight from this. You can see that mentors are crucial to your success. And it's an absolute must if you plan on building a future in this business. All right. So thank you so much for your time, Kira. It's always good talking to you.
Thank you. Likewise.
Thank you for listening. We hope you enjoyed the Bulletproof Cashflow podcast. For more free podcasts, articles, videos, and resources, go to www.bulletproofcashflow.com.